Good evening and welcome to the 9th edition of the SGR Strategy Guide Reviews. That's what SGR stands for. Book of the Month podcast. My name is Ross Polly. I am partaking in a wonderful Belgian white shock top.
Actually, that's a really good beer.
I want to drink like a Blue Moon, but I want to class it up a little bit by having like this orange thing with a mohawk on it.
And sunglasses. So you got like Guy Fieri in Orange Slice.
It's fantastic. With us this week is your name Marcus or Blake? I forget. Blake Grunman! Blake Grunman, how are you doing? What you drinking?
I am drinking a two-hearted ale tonight. Yeah.
How originally you do that all the time?
Wait, it's fucking delicious. It's either that or I was going to have dragon's mead, but I figured I didn't want to get too fucked up too fast.
No, that's never the answer.
No, dragon's mead is so fucking good, man. No,
it's so good. Chris Nitz, what are you drinking? Is it a rum and coke?
I am definitely not drinking a fucking dragon's mead. Drinking a La Fin du Monde before... We podcasted like an hour ago.
What did you say?
It's a unibrow beard. It's a Le Fin du Monde.
It's a unibrow beard?
No. Unibrow beard? What does that even mean?
Didn't you... I'm going sober for the new year?
Yeah, well, I had to podcast with Blake, so in order to...
That makes sense.
Handle right,
just for the record, actually, after we record this podcast, I'm not drinking until I go back to Michigan. You know, I'm trying to lose a little weight, you know, just figured this couldn't hurt, so I'm not drinking either.
And, who are you?
I like how we're doing the Brady Bunch thing. Carrie! Carrie, what are you drinking tonight?
Yes, Carrie, what's going on up there?
Carrie! I remember her.
Yes, Carrie is back! Woo!
I own the site. I don't know. I don't know what I'm doing here either.
It's okay. We don't know what you're doing here either, in your defense, but yes.
You're the DD sipping on your wine.
What are you drinking?
I am drinking a Meiomi, a Pinot Noir that my parents left last time they were at my house. They brought three bottles of wine, bought eight.
Holy fuck.
And then
they were going to be here for like a day and a half.
Actually, that was not too far from it.
I was joking.
It's like Pokemon, okay? They just bring their wine, and then they go, like, trade them.
They came in.
I thought you were saying they drink it, and then they end up, like, Snorlax asleep on the floor.
So they came in a Saturday because they were going to watch the kids while I was doing the Dallas Half Marathon, since Sean wasn't here. And so they came in that day, so we had all that wine, and then they left Sunday right after the Half Marathon, and they left me four bottles. They took the rest home and left me four. So I took three over to my best friend's place for New Year's, and we only drank two. So this is the only time I get to drink this kind of wine is when my parents buy it and leave it.
The fancy smancy shit.
Because it's really good.
So you're saying you drink bad wine normally?
No, I never drink bad wine, but not as good as this.
Fair enough. Okay.
I am kind of sad that you're not drinking it out of Big Steve.
I am sorry, but this is actually from Willamette Valley.
Hey, I've been there.
They make really good Pinot, as I learned when I went on the wine walk. They make really great Pinot.
Man, I wanted to go on a wine walk.
Aww. You were invited.
I know, but I had to fly back.
Not my fault.
I'm sorry, I had to work.
You also missed on the best barbecue lunch ever. Right, Chris?
That barbecue lunch was fucking fantastic. Ross, the best thing that we did experienced
was that barbecue. barbecue and wine.
I mean, we know you go.
It was like wine country, but not really known for the barbecue.
Yeah, I was really surprised that
barbecue,
it was really good
salmon,
barbecue.
Yes. Oh, man.
Barbecue salmon. Sounds fucking amazing.
Oh, no, this was salmon, like man. Some little freaking hole in the wall.
That's like
barbecue
what we
joint.
Had for like Thanksgiving. Like, there's like turkey
barbecue. Wait. This is not a wine podcast, or I'd really love to make it a barbecue podcast.
Barbecue salmon, though?
I have tasted some good barbecue. This is a book of the month, right? Like, I have to look at my recording.
Chris, you don't understand. Ross needs food badly.
Oh, well, you're going to have to break a pot, and I already shot the turkey, so I'm sorry, dude.
Seriously, fuck the turkey.
I shot the turkey.
Yeah, I wonder why.
Somebody shot the food. Did you not like how it was prepared?
I did not like how it was prepared. It was prepared badly.
All right, so we should probably explain ourselves at this point.
How brave.
Right, so the book of the month this month was Gauntlet, and I totally picked it because it was free on PlayStation Plus, and then it was Gauntlet, and I was like, it's Gauntlet! I was like, how can you not just instantly pick Gauntlet? Of which, Blake, if you listened to last month's book of the month, Blake was like, what the fuck's Gauntlet? I don't understand. Why Gauntlet? I'm a total... Whatever. You make me sad, Blake.
Yeah, I was very happy when I heard the podcast that you guys picked Gauntlet, because Gauntlet's actually very special to me.
Oh.
Gauntlet is what got me back into gaming.
Oh, that's right. Yeah. Okay, yeah.
I always talk about my dark period, because I didn't play anything from the NES on.
You wore dark clothes, you know, painted your nails to the dark.
And all the time.
Hidden corners, wore hoodies a lot.
I'm still wearing a hoodie,
quite a bit.
I met a friend in grad school she was playing Gauntlet Seven Sorrows on the PS2, and that was actually a really good introduction for me to get back in, you know, to go from the NES controller to the PS2 controller, because I was like, oh my god, I went from a D-pad and two buttons, and this is too much. And so she's like, well, just play this with me, because you use just one analog stick and about three of the buttons, and then I think a couple of the front buttons, and it introduced it to you gradually. So that was a really good. We played that. So guys, we found all the keys where you can unlock the different costumes.
That was PS1 or PS2.
PS2.
Okay.
That was such a great game.
It was great. It was so great. Like I beat it, I don't know how many times, and then she's like, okay, you're ready to expand with your knowledge with the PS2 games. Here's Kingdom Hearts.
Jesus Christ! Why didn't she just throw you off a cliff? That's quite a jump.
And then the rest is history. Yes, it was quite a jump, but
so I am curious though, because you say that the PS2 controller was really intimidating. Mm-hmm. What about the N64 controller?
Have you never heard my story about the N64 controller?
I remember you talking about GoldenEye or something. How was that? That would have been the terrifying one. That looks like Satan's Trident. It's awful.
It was awful. Like, and the thing is, like, you know, it's with a bunch of people who this is what they played all the time. They played Quake and they played GoldenEye all the time on the N64. And so or Mario Kart. And so they were trying to get me to play with them, and I've never played a first-person anything, and I'm trying to play it, and they're trying to tell me all the buttons do, and I keep dropping all the weapons, and I just would slap people, and I couldn't figure out how to get in through a door.
The boards just...
Yeah, just like I was a drunk person, just hitting
the door frame.
And I just... That controller was... The PS2 was so much more friendly compared to that, because at least like when I put my hands on, I was like, okay, this actually makes sense where I put my fingers for the buttons, and versus the N64, I was like, how am I supposed to hold this?
You know, like this.
And then I was like, what finger do I put on the trigger, and then how do I hold these two buttons
Here? That was the real kicker. All right, so I'm going to play GoldenEye. The left hand, you're using the stick. Yeah. It's got a fucking trigger on it, but that's not your fucking trigger.
No.
It's a trigger! What's so hard about it?
He throws grenades. Or what did it do? Did that move the camera?
It was the zoom. It would do the little zoom thing with the reticle.
Z for zoom, obviously.
Yeah, that's what it was for. The thing was, you couldn't move. You couldn't move at the same time as you aimed the reticle. You had to stay stationary.
Right, you'd stop and aim, which is why everyone hated it when you played Odd Job.
Uh-huh. Well, yeah, Odd Job was a dick. Fuck Odd Job.
So,
anyway.
They made it again.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. They made it again, yes.
And then they released it, and it was free on PlayStation Plus. And so, awesome. Chris picked it.
Yeah. Because it was Gauntlet. Gauntlet is an easy game to just... You can either grind through it yourself, or I figured, you know, at least at some point over the month, you know, at that point, we didn't know if Kara was going to be back with us or not. So I was like, at least the three of us at some point may be able to light up a point to, like, trying to play it. Mm-hmm. And really, what ended up happening is I don't think anybody played with Ross. Did anybody play with Ross?
Nobody plays with Ross, ever.
Well, he was... too busy playing his other addictions.
He was busy playing the game, Let's Reconstruct My Basement.
Yeah. No, that is not true. Oh. After Chris and I logged off one night, I saw him online playing was like NHL game or something.
Motherfucker!
Oh, yeah, I did that when we were... I played one game of NHL.
And by the way, NHL 16, great record.
We were like watching TV, I think. Yeah, we were watching football.
Did they finally add the other missing features back in?
Whatever. We're not talking about NHL. So,
okay, fine.
Carrie and I played over our lunch break once, and then I understand Carrie and Blake played.
Correct. We played two nights ago? Something like that? Yeah.
So I hope Ross got to play. I mean, you can play it single player, but I was like...
And I did.
I was like, it's Gauntlet, so...
Yeah.
You know,
I played the first four levels single player and then replayed those again with Carrie when we were playing together.
I played through the first boss.
Really? Wow.
Three times.
Blake and I played through the first boss.
Yeah, we played through the first boss co-op together. But then, like, I had originally started out just to get it under my fingers before we started playing so I didn't embarrass myself. I played the first four stages just to kind of get familiar with it. But I played that all via remote play, by the way. So that was an interesting transition.
So I played it. I bought the Necromancer because I was like, I got the game for free. I'll pay the $5.
How much was it? That was $5?
$5.
For one character?
For the Necromancer. Okay. And the Necromancer is a very interesting play strategy. Not quite my thing, because his basic attack is like you swing and then the attack happens further away from your character. It's like that.
The wizard?
Necromancer.
No, the Necromancer.
Have you played the wizard though?
I tried.
No, I have.
I noped out of that.
Doesn't have a basic attack.
No.
It's like you got to compound all the spell. And yeah,
isn't it like Magicka?
It's similar to Magicka, but it's like you combine two elements, and then you use the right analog to actually cast it. Like the first time I was walking around, and I was like, "How do I get through these like barrels? They have gold in them. I want them, but I can't figure out."
I want all the pottery to break.
Like, and you hit all the buttons, and like, okay, I see the little spell icons, but how do I cast the spell? I'm pressed.
The wizard.
I was a wizard for all of 10 seconds, and I think I was playing with Chris, and I was like, okay, no, I gotta back the fuck out. I'm sorry. We gotta quit.
It's hard.
Yeah, I tried the wizard. I was like, no, not doing that. I did the necromancer for quite a while, because you could actually use the right analog stick and just, like, zip through enemies and kill them, and that would help build your undead summoning count, but then it only tops out at 5, so, like, you really had to pay attention to that that counter. But it was cool because once I had, like, you know, you could do 5, and then if you had a couple summoning pillars, you could actually keep zooming through. So at one point I had like 25 minions just doing my bidding for them.
Holy hell.
That was pretty cool. But like your basic attack, my problem with the necromancers, you swing, your swing goes here, your actual attack happens like a couple, you know, it's a couple feet away.
There's like a barrier in between where your attack is.
Yeah.
And your
if there's an enemy in between that, from like where your staff goes to where the actual attack happens, if there's an enemy in between that space, they don't get hit.
Really?
So that part sucked. So then I tried the warrior, and then I just kept dying. In like every time I get mobbed. So I just stuck to the elf because I just finally figured out I could just kite around all the little square rooms and just keep killing shit and just bombing everything. I was like, this is the best shit ever.
As myself, it was the elf. And I was like, okay, I don't like this. So I was the Valkyrie. And then Chris and I played. He was the elf and I was the Valkyrie. And I died like constantly because every time I got surrounded, that was it. And I saw how much easier of a time Chris was having. So when I played with Blake and when I played by myself, I stuck with the elf, and I finished the entire game as the elf. And
you did?
Yeah, that's to me the
in single player.
Yeah, ranged combat's the only way to go in this game.
I mean, as soon as you figure out the kiting aspect, and you can figure out the room layouts, it's so easy because you can easily kite shit around the room, and then bomb the stuff that you need to bomb, and that's why. Like, I've tried the elf's other various specs, and I'm just like, no, if I can place a bomb and then just drag the group of people that I am currently dragging around the room into the bomb, I'm good to go. So, yeah, and I really chose it because, let's face it, White Wizard Needs Food Badly was like a big thing, and I was like, I really hope when I picked the game, I was like, I really hope they bring all that stuff in. So when I first started playing it, I was so pleased that all of the stupid one-liners were still there.
They made it a parody, I thought.
Yeah, they really. Yeah. I feel like they kind of picked up on the fact that it was just like a big joke, and so they fed into it really well.
Oh, they did. And like every time I shot some food, your character is like, "Why are you killing the food?
Destroying the food. What an interesting strategy."
Seriously, fuck you, Carrie. The number of times that I needed help, and she's sitting back there with her arrows, nuking the food, and laughing. And here's the worst part. You know what she said she learned? She learned it from you, Chris, you son of a bitch.
Because when I was a Valkyrie, I was charging it all the times, and he killed all the food.
Yeah. Yeah.
And got all the gold.
And I'm like, what the fuck, Carrie? And she goes, this is what Chris did to me. You have to deal with it.
I was actually meaner to Blake than Chris was to me when Blake died. When Blake died.
Well, what the actual fuck? Man?
Okay, so I'm wearing the crown, and I died, and Blake scooped it up like, motherfucker! And then he dies, so I immediately go up and get the crown, and I take his gold, and I shoot all the food. Like, take that.
So if you haven't played the new the Gauntlet Slayer edition, every once in a while an enemy will come on the screen that has a crown, and that's like 500 extra gold or something that when you end the level. So you want to basically carry that crown, but if you're playing with other people, if somebody's carrying the crown, when they die, they leave a pile of gold. And their crown goes flying off. So you can run and go take the crown, take some of their money, and then if you're in a room with food, obviously you can, like, destroy all the food.
You
then shoot all the gold pots and take all the gold, too. So that way, when they were... So
this fucking guy.
You have... the fun thing is, like, there's this respawn counter up in the top, and it's based off of gold, how much gold you pick up.
Mm-hmm.
So, if you're playing two-player, it's a shared respawn pool.
It's actually based on the enemies you kill.
I thought it was gold-based.
Yep. Nope, enemies you kill.
It's enemies you killed.
Yep.
So, there's a finite amount of respawns. And really, if you have the crown, the first thing I do every time I was playing, even in solo player, is I would instantly move my little ghost thing over to where the crown was at, because I realized that you could respawn just in time to pick up the crown again.
Yep.
And then go back and get your gold.
But if the crown will disappear after a certain amount of time.
Yes. Mm-hmm. But if you're playing multiplayer, you can be a dick and go steal the crown and then take their gold before they have a chance to spawn, and then you can kill all the gold.
Yep.
It's such a...
I normally never touched Blake's gold, but when he took the crown off my dead body, I was like, that's it, motherfucker.
Well, all right, so let's also just take a step back. Carrie's supposed to be the nice, sweet one on this fucking show, and she's trolling me,
have
too.
Have you met Carrie?
Yeah, fair enough.
I'm gonna say.
This is Gauntlet. There is no
whole. She's almost got an LAPD rap sheet. Almost. So, yes, okay.
Did not.
Almost.
No.
Yes. Yes, she did, Carrie.
But
I do like the Valkyrie's, like, shield move, where if you threw the shield, they would hit, and it would continuously bounce off all the enemies.
It'd go full, like Captain America.
It's the Crusader off of Diablo 3.
Yes.
Yeah.
Which I would say when I played Diablo, I was like, oh, I'm Captain Americaing the shit out of everything.
Yeah. Exactly.
That's
cool. But then there's Chris just cutting all the shit in a nice, neat circle.
Yes, that's kind of what I did. Every now and then sniping in the straight line.
Well, and that actually worked out really well, because Carrie would kind of get them all chasing behind her, then she would go running by me, and I'd use my big, like, area attack, where essentially it was either I'd go plowing straight forward, or I'd just do, like, the big spinning tornado and just smoke a ball as they come running by. So it really worked out quite well.
Smoke a ball as they would be.
Smoke a ball.
I would smoke a ball.
Hey, gosh!
take a big old rip. And then, I'd fuck those guys up.
Yeah,
it was great.
I do have to say, if you're playing with other people, it's good to have one ranged and one melee, because you are able really well.
You feed into each other really well, actually. Yeah.
So I played...
It's really funny, because when Blake and I got to that first boss together, because I already done it, so I knew the... Because it's not obvious how to beat that first boss. Mm-hmm. And... I wish I could say the same for the rest of them. The rest were kind of letdowns after that. The first boss on there telling Blake what to do, and at one point we both died. There's only one skull coin left. Like, who gets it? Blake's like,
Carrie,
why don't you get it? Because and I think the reason why I said that, because one, I'd already done it before, and two, because of my kiting ability, I could avoid enemies
versus
that I
me,
could, and I could kill.
I just
a
sit
lot
there like
more.
A big dumb moron and just sit there,
I could kill a lot more to get them get another skull coin, which I did.
Exactly.
And
she had more agility. So it made more sense, honestly.
To kill that boss together.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, unfortunately, like, the last two bosses were...
Meh. Letdowns.
Well, because that first one, like, it's basically a giant mummy. And it's not obvious how to kill him at all. You kind of have to, like, what is
like
this thing
unravel.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. This isn't a Scooby-Doo episode, Ross. Come on.
But the other two, it's pretty time. Much a shoot 'em.
Yep. Yep. So it was literally like, oh, hey, there they are. Light them up.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's disappointing.
Well, I mean, the third one was a little more complicated than that, but nothing like the first one.
Yeah. Well, I mean, you do hear a lot of people say that as game designers, they kind of design their game backwards. They start at the end of the game and work their way to the front. This might have been a good example of that, where lessons learned led to what they ended up with that first boss. And then after that, you know, it was kind of a letdown because... You know, you ended up getting the stuff that was from earlier on in the development.
Well, I think that they designed this game more for playing the endless.
Yeah.
Oh, you mean where it just keeps coming and coming and coming?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Than anything else. I mean,
I never got to play the endless. What is entailed in that?
It's just,
is that just like you're just sitting there continuous?
You get into a room and it's just how many levels can you go down? Like how much further?
Like the original
how count. Long? How long yeah. can yeah?
How many floors? How many floors can you clear?
Yeah.
Okay. And is it randomly generated or?
Yes.
Okay. All right. I figured
and I went
as much,
looked at,
but
I went and looked at the leaderboard. So Chris, I did double check this. So the number one on the endless was 2,176 floors.
What the actual fuck?
I can't even imagine how long that's like a full day of playing.
That is like you need a poop sock and a piss bucket. Pull that off. That's crazy.
Because it's not really like
you do that.
It's not like you're leveling up in this game and getting more powerful. I mean, you can unlock new relics and things like that, but you're
you remain relatively the same skill level. You just get different skills.
Right.
Well, because some of those skills really make a difference. So, like, if you're the necromancer and you have 25 of your little mummies, you can basically build a wall and. Your little minions,
wall of dead bodies.
Your minions are taking care of everything while you're sitting in the safe zone, and you're constantly
Ross looks
getting.
Like he's posing for a headshot. Yeah.
So while your undead risen army is killing stuff, you're constantly regenerating them. So you can basically sit in a corner with a necromancer. Whereas you know if you're the
I
elf,
what they probably did. Was they didn't shoot the food and they like ate it?
What? No, no, you shoot that.
You're talking to the people who actually did.
Yeah, that's how they got to 2000.
No, the only time that I ever saved the food was during the gold, like all the little gold caves. That was the only time that I made sure that I knew where all the food was at, so I didn't accidentally shoot it. And if you had a potion, because you could like throw the potion for a bomb.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it pissed me off every time I shot a potion.
Like, God damn it.
Yeah, same here.
Because you could carry five of them, right? Like, so
right.
When you had the little pyramid things that would be spawning pools, you could just drop a nice little potion on it, blow it up, and call it a day. No, if I shot one, I was so pissed. If I shot food,
I don't care. But
if I shot food, I was like, yeah, it's just food. I'll just keep kiting. If I shot a potion, I was like, God damn it.
Yeah. There's always more turkey.
Chris is kind of like Mad Max. You don't care about, you know, finding water or gas, but you get really pissed when you accidentally shoot your gun.
Yeah, exactly. As soon as I shot my gun, I was pissed. But water, I could get that shit out of a hubcap. It was fine. I didn't have to worry about it. Oh, yeah. And anyway, this is a different game. So, yeah.
Okay.
Gauntlet, yeah.
I keep shooting the food because I want
to
see if I can get that
spiteful.
Trophy. No, because there's a trophy if you shoot 5,000 food.
Yeah. Well,
shoot it on your own time, damn it! No. Quit doing it on mine.
Oh, I actually jumped on like a public game just to see how that would work. Oh, that was not fun. All the food either was taken or shot, and then every time I died, my gold was collected.
Oh, right. No, hold on. So they were trolling you.
No,
and they wanted
they were
you
just,
to die so they could steal all
the shit. No, they were just playing the game.
It was everybody for himself.
Yeah,
basically.
It was. I mean, it was the way the game was designed. I mean, let's
all
face
for
it.
One
it's Gauntlet. It's not meant to be a friendly. It is.
I mean, hell, I remember in Seven Sorrows that if you broke open a crate and had food in it, and the person would come in and take your food, your character would say, "I needed that," or something, you know.
Sometimes I would clear a floor and be just on one bubble of health, and had to listen to that fucking elf be like, "I really wish I had some of that elf bread. I really wish I had some of that elf bread." I was like, "Yes, I understand. But, like the three other people I'm playing with, keep taking the fucking elf bread."
The worst was, I'm getting low on health. I see, like, a big old fucking juicy turkey right in front of me. Carrie shoots it, and what do I hear? "What, did it not smell good enough?" I was like, "Oh, fuck you! Fuck you! I wanted that fucking turkey! I needed that turkey!"
This, you know what? I am actually kind of glad I didn't play with Ross, because I could totally see Ross trolling. Like, run up, take the food, and then kill the rest of the food. Because there were several times you could tell that they were like...
"And steal all your shit."
Well, you could tell that there were several times...
"I have to unlock more hats."
Capes. You need the capes.
Nah.
Well, all the capes are unlocked. It's the hats.
I thought it was the capes that was locked away.
No, it's the hats.
So the hats are the only thing that's like locked away, but it adds no benefit to you.
No, it does. It's
like, this is the in fashion.
Hey, I have been saving up my 50,000 gold so I could get my awesome face mask.
Because
I'm all like, I really need these different runes and all that, and I'm just like, I really want that fashion. I really need that fashion, but this is more useful.
Oh, man.
What the fuck, man?
I am
curious to see, though, when you played in that public game, Chris, how long did you end up lasting?
Oh, we lasted.
Like, how long did you, before you said fuck it and didn't want to put up with this shit anymore?
Oh, no, I kept playing, because I eventually learned how to play.
Okay, so how long did you play?
We played all the way through the first boss.
Oh, okay.
Was it
four player?
It was 3 to 4 players, depending on...
Mm-hmm.
On levels, because some people would drop in, some people would come out, and
so could you only have people drop in at the beginning of a stage?
Yes.
So essentially, you could sit there and wait and hope that a fourth person would pop in.
I mean, this is a public game, so nobody waited around for shit. It was a mad race to the very end, and thankfully, because when I finally was like, I'm gonna play a pug, as they say in the MMOs. By the time I finally decided to do that, I had already...
Pick up game.
Oh, okay, gotcha.
Pick up game.
Sorry, I don't know the cool lingo that you kids have.
By the time, when you go down to the park and there's all these people playing basketball and you just...
Hell yeah, pick up game, man.
Yeah, there you go.
So that's
Pass me to rock.
That's what it is. So by the time I had finally decided to do that, I'd already played through several times the very first boss. So I was just like, I'll start at the first level and just try to... snag a pug and see what happens. And we made it to the first boss. And after the first boss, I was just like, yeah, I'm sick and tired of, like, kiting all these people around and then people stealing the food. Because, like, I'm the one that's running in all these circles, killing all the shit. And then I need food and I go to snag the food and then it's either gone or somebody destroys it. I'm just like, yeah, no. So it's definitely something a lot more fun to play with friends, especially if you can do the party chat on PS4, because it's so much...
Oh, yeah.
It's so much more entertaining that way.
I've still never played a game with Ross.
Yeah, and I really wish I had, too.
You know, I was trying to think about it. Ross, have I ever played a game with you?
You guys have played Left 4 Dead together.
And Need for Speed.
Need for Speed, Magicka.
We've all played games, but, like...
But I've never played a game with Chris.
Gauntlet! I mean, Carrie.
Yep, Carrie's the only one you haven't played a game with.
Ever.
You've played Need for Speed.
Ever.
Yeah. That's crazy. How does that happen?
Yeah.
She even tried to make... Dude, she even tried to make the effort, too.
Yeah.
Maybe he's just an asshole.
What do you mean?
No, his fault's his basement.
Yeah, it's not his fault that nature's a dick.
Yeah, I knew it was a bad sign when I saw Ross tweet, well, looks like it's time to get an apartment again. I was like, what the fuck? What just happened? Did you burn your house down? What did you do?
Yeah, I saw Audrey post. And I was almost going to be pulling Ross and be like, well, you shouldn't live in a sub because it's not your sub pump that you need.
It wasn't my sub pump.
It was your sump pump that needs
it wasn't. It was a. It was the it was, pipe leading outside where like you hook up garden hoses.
Yeah.
Right. Like it started leaking and then froze and then burst, and so it came down from the ceiling into my basement.
Oh.
So like,
and you have a finished basement too, don't you? Too.
Yeah, he has.
Well,
a finished
I used
basement.
To.
Oh,
hey,
sucks,
and then I moved out of my house in Madison, and their sewer line backed up and caused $6,000 worth of damage. And I had to look at the Facebook pictures of the $2,000 worth of repairs we had done in the basement be torn apart.
God. Did they? Hopefully, they didn't try to blame you for that shit. That sucks.
Oh no. It was. They were already past their year of warranty incoming after us.
Yeah. Oh my
so
god, that's the worst.
My yeah. Also my internet connection to the house is in through the basement.
Right.
In the wall that had to get replaced.
Has it been replaced yet?
No, the wall's still out, but. And we just have, like, the outlets just sort of sitting there dangling, and we have it all hooked up. And, like, the only thing down there
tape,
is the equipment to hook up the internet.
He's got his priorities in order, at least.
I do. And I got the PlayStation and everything all hooked up upstairs. But while the fans were going downstairs to dry everything out, the extension cord was coming up to this corner, and when I turned on the TV and the PlayStation at the same time, that was just enough that twice while playing Gauntlet, I tripped the breaker and just cut out that corner.
That was extra life, like when you guys were trying to all hook up on one socket
yeah.
and everything. And then, yeah, so we had to.
Yeah, but this is like.
Circuits.
So I did have a very hard time playing this game, but I got it in.
I give you credit because like you were getting ready to play, and then your basement does it. You have this pipe freeze.
Basement decides to take a piss.
I give you credit for sticking through it and actually trying and actually getting through to play it. So,
well, I think we should, you know, when things settle down for Ross, he's able to do this. We should play in a play date, the four of us.
Fuck yeah!
Yeah, I think all four of us playing Gauntlet would actually be pretty fun. So
it would be more fun than one of us playing.
Now just imagine all four of us fighting over one plate of turkey
every game. Well, then we just won't die. So
four of us need to play on hard is what needs to happen.
Yeah, so I tried playing.
No. Normal is too easy with two people.
Yeah.
Oh, it is.
Normal is really easy.
Well, yeah, that's what you and I played. It was easy.
Yeah, it was. Yeah, it was.
When I was playing, I played on normal as the wizard, and I got through the first couple levels, but, like, he doesn't have, like, a consistent attack. There's not, like, this kills enemies. So the best one is, like, the ice beam, but, like, it takes a charge, and then it goes, and then it, like, slowly drains the front line. So if you're far away, it's great, because you just keep, like, moving it a little bit back and forth, and all of the zombies walk into it and die. Mm-hmm. But, like, if they're all up on you, there's, like, no great spell. There's, like, one that causes, like, a boom and knocks everything away, but then it has a recharge timer on it. So you just, like, run away, and you have to, like, keep switching spells, and there's, like, a shield, but they just go through that right away. It's
yeah, you can definitely tell the game was designed to have, you know, multiple people play.
Yeah, because I think I got through four rooms with the Valkyrie on normal, and said, you know what, this is not fun, and went to easy, and that's the only way to play by yourself is easy. So I played normal with Chris, and played normal with Blake. I'm like, yes, that's almost too easy with two people. So with four people, definitely hard.
I'm curious if the difficulty ramps at all, or if it's literally just they just throw more enemies at you, or they have enemies with bigger health bars.
The difficulty does not ramp with the more people. It stays the same.
They just throw more shit at you, essentially.
Yeah, because all the difficulty does is that the enemies, your attacks are weaker, the higher difficulty, and the enemies spawn faster.
Oh, great. So you're double fucked. Great.
Yeah.
Mm. Good to know. So is hard the highest difficulty, or is there one higher?
I know, it's just hard.
Yeah.
Okay. But yeah, I definitely think we should do this four player. This would be fun.
And I essentially just farm hard mode. just for gold, so.
Because Chris is a better gamer than I am, so.
Come on. He knows how this rolls. You just got to sit there and get out of gold.
I need somebody's help clearing out one cave, because there's one cave I can't do.
But there was one thing, though, that kind of, like, I don't know that there was any one skill or weapon or anything that you bought that really made any character that I played with overpowered. Like, it seemed like it literally just provided you with a different way to do an attack. You didn't have any extra power, and really, it came right down to it. You could buy anything at any time, and it wouldn't provide you any incremental improvement in anything. It literally just
caters to a different way for you to play.
Exactly.
Yeah.
It allowed you to find a different strategy to work with your playstyle.
Yeah, and that's exactly what I ended up doing with both the Necromancer and the Elf, was that I just unlocked the way that I wanted to play those characters.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And then as soon as I did that, I was like, okay, well, now this is a lot more fun because I'm doing the things that I'd feel beneficial to my playstyle.
Which, to me, this made it a more dynamic Gauntlet than Gauntlet games of the past, because, you know, the original game, it's like, no matter who you are, your attacks do the same.
Right.
Same amount of damage, the same amount of health, all that. It's because there's an old Midway arcade game.
Now there's
game,
one,
and,
wow.
That's who had it.
Yeah, it is. Right.
I still have my Midway arcade treasures on my GameCube that has the original Gauntlet on there.
I have that on PS2, and I think I have Midway Treasures 2 on Xbox, the original Xbox. So I think
you don't even have a PS2. That's interesting.
Yeah, I do. I have a PS2.
Oh, you do now? Okay.
Yeah, it's right back there. You can see it on top of my TV.
Okay. I thought you didn't have one.
Right there? Nope. I got that about a year ago.
Oh, okay. That makes more sense.
Yeah. Craigslist, it's a wonderful thing.
And Seven Sorrows was kind of the same thing. It didn't matter which character you picked. There was a little bit of differences in terms of, like, the female barbarian moved slow. She moved really slow, to the point that me and my friend called her Betsy Big Butt. She moved so slow. And the archer moved much quicker, instead of the wizards. But on the other hand, Betsy Big Butt and I think the warrior had stronger attacks. So that was, but that was only dynamic differences between the two. And this one, I really felt like, and Chris, in the second Gauntlet game for the PS2 was really, really bad. Let's just never speak of that again. Yeah. But this Gauntlet game, I felt like it didn't level you up like the last, like Seven Sorrows did. Like, you actually leveled up. This is just, no, here's how you can lock ways to, you know, help you find your unique way to play, which is kind of what I felt like Dragon's Crown did as well, which is one reason why I really like Dragon's Crown, because that was really all about finding which character fit you best.
And yeah, that's how, like, League of Legends works and stuff, too.
Oh, shut up.
Fuck you, man.
Jesus Christ.
Fuck League of Legends. I'm so sick of hearing about that goddamn game.
Okay, so we all gave Gauntlet thumbs up.
I give Gauntlet thumbs up.
It was great for a free game.
I mean, for like a one-player game, I don't know.
One player,
it's fun to a point. I will definitely say that
I think the
game gets exponentially more fun the number of people that you actually know that are playing the game.
It's definitely a game that's based off of, I mean, you definitely want to have friends. It feels
like a Towerfall type game, a Towerfall Ascension game.
It takes that whole couch co-op thing. It was like that too.
You were trying to get on the arcade cabinet with three of your friends to play.
But it's still definitely doable single player. It just takes a lot more concentration where... time you shot, like, the food, if you're playing single player, if you shot food, it pissed you off. And then I actually found myself leaving food behind because I was like, okay, if I clear out a room, I can go back and get the food. And then I got pissed when the door was like, no, you have to keep
door
moving. And I was like,
you're like, God damn these metal grates, go away.
Oh, yeah, that... But yeah,
who
I mean, it's
barracks like this.
It is essentially the original Gauntlet, where it is geared for you to be playing with friends. So when Karen and I did it, it was so much easier. Like, we just steamrolled through levels where I had to play them two or three times to actually learn all the enemy patterns, where all the spawn points were. Learned while the food was
at. Anytime we got to a level where death spawned, it was like, oh shit, forget the food, forget the gold, just go, 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 go.
Yeah. Exactly. Whoa! again.
Or you've already played that level so many times, like I already knew where all the gold was. Like, you start learning. Here's where the food's at. Here's where the gold's at.
Yeah, I never played
at.
That much.
And so, like, I knew, okay, so I'll go over here, collect all these little pots that have the gold. I'll snake this turkey and then go into the next room. Or hopefully I can sit at this very point and have the enemies from the next room kind of start funneling in and kill them.
Right. You have like, a doorway or a choke point where you can kind of just sit there and nuke them as they come walking through.
Yeah. So it was, and I mean, this game's still very much, I'm still playing this. It's still a lot of fun. So
I do have to ask, though. I just looked it up, and the actual retail price, if you were to buy it non-PSN member, it's $20.
I'd pay $20 for it.
Yeah, I probably would.
Worth it?
Yeah.
I'm going to say for single player, maybe not. Multiplayer, if you have friends that you know will be able to play it with you, absolutely. Single player, I don't know.
No, I'd still play it. I'd still pay $20.
I would have played it regardless because Gauntlet has a special place in my heart. So.
And I'm not saying that it's bad. I just feel like, for my money, I feel like there's better ways that you could spend $20 on the PSN. However, if you do know that you're going to have people that you could play with, honestly, if I had paid $20 for it and I got the play session that Carrie and I had on, you know, more than a couple of occasions, that would justify it for me. Honest. It absolutely would. It was fun.
He'd rather spend that $20 buying another version of Max Payne 3.
Yeah.
No, that's not true.
He's got Farming Simulator 2017 to invest in. No.
Come on, Destiny emotes, motherfucker.
Destiny.
Come on.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's better.
That guy does the fucking Thriller dance. The Thriller dance! It's amazing! He does the Carlton and the Thriller. It's fucking awesome.
All right, I need another drink. So, Carrie, before I roam out to get another drink, what is our next book of the month, Carrie? Because it is your choice now.
I have two in mind.
Oh,
and I'm still going back and forth.
I don't think that's how that works.
And which one that I want, because I just
figured that you better pick. You got time.
Veto.
Just because I figured someone would veto. So.
Yep. Which one will we veto least?
I don't know.
right, which one will we not veto more?
Well, one of the ones I was thinking of was Life is Strange.
But you both have played it.
So?
So. That's so
you better get to work, Blake.
You're going to force us to play. God damn it. Okay.
My other idea was The Deadly Tower of Monsters.
What the fuck is that?
It apparently is a hilarious game that has a very positive rating on Steam.
I've never heard of this game.
Reviewed it for PlayStation Lifestyle. It is a Steam and PSN game.
Okay.
It is $15, so it's cheaper than Life is Strange.
Actually, if you get it on Steam, it is under $10 at this current moment.
Holy damn. Yeah. Okay.
But it is basically what it is just think of any sci-fi B movie you can think of. That would be a Mystery Science Theater 3000.
Okay.
And you're playing that, but you're playing it like it's a DVD re-release and there's director commentary.
Ooh! I'm in! Yes,
like, you can actually,
this.
like you'll see, like, things flying and you'll see the strings on them.
Oh my god, yes!
If you stand still for too long, the director will say stuff like, well, in this scene, I just had them stand for a little while and do nothing. You know, it's
so it's like Stanley Parable, but it fucks with you.
I don't know what Stanley Parable is. So.
Good!
Oh, this game's so fun.
Oh my, exist in that life, in that universe.
Oh, it's so good!
For as long as possible.
Fuck you, man! That's a great game!
I can say this, Carrie. You and I have already discussed Life is Strange. We both know how this is going to work. And really, the only reason why we were picking it is to see how these two were going to play through it.
I have actively avoided Life is Strange because I figured it would be one of the Book of the Month Club games eventually.
I played the Deadly Tower of Monsters because it.
I think we should just play the Deadly Tower.
It's up to Carrie.
Can call Life is Strange later. You know, force us to play it later on.
Because then it comes down to me or Carrie again, and I mean at that point it's another 3 months out. So.
Okay, I'm just saying.
There won't be any more video games released.
Because I would, Because I also would like to get what Blake and Ross do as far as their choices in Life is Strange to see what route they go.
All right, Carrie. So it's going to be a tough decision.
I do too, but I just think Deadly Tower of Monsters would be more fun.
I went through these months where my sister would go, you got to play Life is Strange. You got to play Life is Strange. And then the final episode came out and she goes, I hate that game and I'm never going to talk about it ever again.
Whoa!
Just cut it off.
I know exactly why she said
wow.
that.
Wow!
Yeah. No, yeah. I can just
wow.
Yeah. And it's really yeah.
Okay, well, let me put it this way, and this is I hate to you know distill it down to this, but the Life is Strange. How much of a time investment are we talking?
10, about 2 to 3 15. Hours an episode.
Oh, okay, so we're looking at like
5 episodes.
10, 15 hours?
Maybe a little more.
Because, yeah, it's a little more. It's about 15 hours.
Because there's a couple episodes that are run long.
Yeah, okay. Like episode 2 takes quite a while, and I think
okay.
episode
4 versus the other one, which is...
Let's see, I'm near the end, and I think I've put in 12 hours. I mean, it's okay. just a different type of gameplay. I mean, one is over the top and silly, and it's action-oriented mm-hmm. combat. Like, it goes back and forth between, it's a top-down, so it's like from between a shooter and a hack and slash, and the other is very much a emo teenager's experience in the world.
Okay.
Great.
I don't think we need to give Ross any more opportunities to be emo, I'm just saying.
Were you
That's
have
me known for my emo-nosity?
That's right. Yep, your emo-ness. I don't know. I got nothing. It's up to you, Carrie.
Now maybe I'll just make one of you guys, or both of you guys, play it for Extra Life.
Oh, that could work.
That could be fun, too, because Chris and I could be in the room just watching you guys.
Because that's not creepy at all. What are they doing? Sit there in the corner leering at them while they're playing.
Right until Ross is like, nope, I'm out. I'm done. I'm good. I've had enough.
That's what happened on one.
No. Ross will be just like his sister, like, although he's like, this is awesome. This is awesome. He's going to get to the end. And he'll either be like, how I was like, okay, this is kind of cool. Be like his sister and be like, oh, fuck this shit.
Yeah. I was about to say, he's going to look at me and go, Blake, fuck this shit.
Because I could also see them getting the two different endings, too. I could see Blake getting, like, one ending and Ross getting the other ending.
So I see Blake doing my ending.
Okay,
yeah,
all
and
right.
I can see
all
Ross
right, children.
Getting my ending.
All right, so...
Although, I think Ross would have a hard... I don't know.
I think this is going to be real hard to listen to.
Okay, I can't decide. I really can't.
God damn it. Okay, flip a coin.
Hold up.
Flip a coin.
Hold
something.
Up.
Yeah. All right, here we go.
Go grab my DBZ coin. I got it at San Diego Comic-Con.
Okay.
So, let's see. Heads, Life is Strange. Tails is...
Whatever the hell that game is.
The Deadly Tower of Monsters. It's got dinosaurs in it.
It does have dinosaurs.
This game sounds fucking amazing,
by the way. It's claymation
dinosaurs. It sounds like something that I'm going to buy and play anyway.
Let's just make it that, because Chris said he wanted it too.
I'm fucking sold. Like, it's like claymation and dinosaurs and Dracula and commentary and bats on strings. Are you fucking kidding me?
And he even gets into sexist commentary.
Oh my god, sign me up!
Yeah, but the other game has teenage angst.
It's a lot of teenage angst.
So much teenage angst that when I was broadcasting it, the people that were watching were commenting on my Facebook posts about it that were like, I couldn't watch it. There was just so much teenager bullshit going on. I was like, but there's so much more meaning behind this. There's so much.
They're like, nope, still just a bitchy little teenager.
You have feelings.
No, like Blake, one of the screenshots I actually took and put on my review was where the director says, like, you know, I just figure if we're not going to hire someone with acting merit, why not make it a hot female?
Nice. Well played. You know what? And the sad part is, I'm probably guessing that's been said in a boardroom somewhere. It has to have been.
Oh, I'm sure. Because, like, this is obviously, like, this is, like, a 1960s film. Because, like, he even says at one point, he's like, do you recognize those trees? Yes, they do look plasticky for a reason. I actually I used them in my aquarium, and I used them in this other movie.
Carrie.
But.
We should just make it this game.
Yeah. Because Chris even said, he's like, I want to play this.
It was so good, in fact, that after we hung up on the phone call yesterday, I literally went and loaded up Steam. As soon as we hung up, loaded up Steam to look and add to my wish list, and was like, oh, this is under $10. Shit, I'll just buy this shit right now.
I'm actually loading up Steam on my phone at this moment, and I'm downloading this game.
And you've been
I would have done this regardless of whether this was our game, just because this game sounds fucking rad. This sounds like it's like right in my
controller support. You know, we can all get together and watch them do life. Because you keep laughing and talking about this game as it is, Carrie.
Yeah, I know. I'll just make them play it for Extra Life.
Yeah, do it.
There we go.
Yeah. That'll
work. Yes, to play your games.
So the Deadly Tower Monsters is available both Steam.
$9.89 on Steam.
Yep.
So there you go.
And downloaded, and bought right now. Done. You've sold me, Carrie. 34% off. Done.
Yeah, I'll just go. I mean, this has been my addiction of the month. Like I had more fun playing this. It's over the top. Like, you even got, like, the overacting actors.
Awesome.
You know, cause it's, you know,
please tell me there's a Shatner lookalike or a Shatner soundalike.
No. At least not yet. But, like, it taps into, like, every cliche and trope you can think of. Like, there's a King Kong boss, there's nuclear ants, invisible men.
Perfect.
All right.
Again, this game sounds fucking rad.
Oh, it is, from what I heard.
It's one of those, like, it's an Atlas game, so I knew it could go.
Oh, it's Atlas. Okay.
I knew go either way for me. I'll either love it or hate it, and it was a lot of fun. It's really the DVD commentary. Oh, and the whole game, it looks like it's a VHS tape. Like, that's the video quality, and if you skip through cutscenes, it's like you're fast-forwarding on a tape.
Nice! Okay, yeah. Seriously, like, everything that you have said about this game just screams, this is my fucking game. This is my jam. I'm excited right now. I want to play this game. Like, let's get this fucking done with so I can go play.
Like, there's this there's three different characters you can play as. And when you start switching between them, the director says, he's like, yes, none of the actors could film on the same day.
Trying to explain the continuity?
Yes.
Awesome.
It'll say things like, you know, people were asking, like, why don't these monsters have the glass domes on their heads to breathe? Well, it's because they're clones and they don't need it. It has nothing to do with the fact that maybe we were over budget and we couldn't afford to get them.
Okay, so is that like an option that you can have the director's commentary, or it's always there?
No, that's part of it.
Oh my god, this game sounds fucking rad. I can't wait. I cannot.
And it's really great when he gets in arguments with the producer of the re-release.
No, motherfucker, that's what happened.
Yeah.
Oh my god.
Yeah, like
sounds like a game I need to play, like, while streaming it.
Or super stoned, one or the other.
Because
exactly.
Every time you die, he'll make a comment. He's like, "Oh, this isn't the right clip," or it's like,
"Oh, that's a long take."
He's like, "Oh, he really got hurt there. We didn't mean to put this one in the final cut." And at one point, like, I think I died like so many times in one area, and the producer said, so why did you keep all this film of your actors getting hurt? Like, oh, I'm sorry that I just suck at playing this.
Oh my god. Alright. Well, don't talk about it anymore. Don't talk about it anymore. We don't need to save it for next month. But oh my god, this game sounds amazing.
Ah, so what have we been playing?
Yeah, Carrie, can't talk about this one.
Nope, I already did. I'm done talking about, so then we can go to either let's go to Blake. What have you been playing?
I have been playing Punch Club. I freaking
is that like Fight Club?
Actually, there is a lot of Fight Club references in the game. I think I described it in my review over on Action Trip. Think of a game dev story, introduce it to your best friend Tyler Durden, and inject it forcibly with HGH. That's pretty much what this game is. It's like a roided out version of just the most ridiculous micromanagement sim you've ever seen in your life. Where and the actual repetitive action of the game, it's like any other micromanagement sim. However, you just got these weird-ass, off-the-wall characters, and then just out of the blue, oh, hey, there's Mickey from Rocky. Or, oh, hey, let's go over to this area over here. Oh, wait a minute. Nope, that's definitely the Godfather sitting there on the patio, and he wants to invite me over. And you're going to do jobs for the Don. You're going to sit there, and you're going to go and collect people's protection money for him. Why the hell not? Or you're going to drive around and you're going to meet your best friend and be introduced to his smoking hot sister, Adrian. It's like, really? Could you be any more on the fucking nose? But it's not just the micromanagement side of things. It's because you go to all these different settings. You're not just stuck in this one main town. You kind of move around. And the thing is, a lot like, you know, they did in Game Dev Story, if your people were not working on developing their skills at a certain point, their skills start to deteriorate. And so the same thing is with your boxer. If you're not in the gym training, you end up, you know, losing a lot of your skills, your strength, your stamina, or your speed. And then the real kicker is, in order to be able to train, you need to have all the food that you need in order to remain strong, in order to perform. And then in order to pay for all that, you have to have the money. You don't make enough money boxing in order to pay for all of your food. So you also have to do side jobs, like those ones where you'll be delivering pizzas, or you'll be going around and beating people up, or you'll be collecting protection money, or you'll be working on a construction site. All this different shit. And you run into all these really cool characters. I ran into Ivan Drago yesterday. Like, it's awesome. It's just so much fun. And they essentially just take and mix in all the different elements from, like, these crazy off-the-wall, dopey, like, fighting action films. I believe on the wall, it's got a picture, like, it's, and by the way, this is all, like, a 16-bit kind of art style. Like, they've got a little poster on the wall, and it's got, like, the look from Rocky where he's got his hand up in the air, except the name of the movie, it says Stoney. Or, you know, just like dippy shit like that, where it's like, they don't want to come out and say it. Where, but it's
Stony.
Yeah, exactly. Or you go to the guy who's running the gym, or running one of the gyms. His name is Mick, of course. And then there's even like some weird ass Double Dragon references in there, because you've got this medallion that all these people are protecting that you've got to go and retrieve from the bad guys. Like, and they gave it to the Don, so you need to try to steal it back from the Don. And then, oh boy, the Don got it, so you've got to go and you've got to go to where? Fucking Russia, of course, because that's where they're going to go and take everything, because that makes total sense. And so then you're following the plot line of fucking Rocky, what is it, Rocky 3? Whatever, is that the Ivan Drago one? But this entire time, you're having to try to seek this balance in between interacting with all the characters in the game, because if you don't interact with people after a while, eventually you'll stop getting like the fun little story nuggets. And they'll like with Adrian, if you're not talking to her for a certain period of time, you're like, hey baby, you know, just kind of like, and she's like, are you even my boyfriend? We never talk anymore. And so then you've got to waste a bunch of fucking time talking to them and building up their trust. And so it's like this weird juggling act. So honestly, if you want to succeed at this game, just say fuck y'all to everybody in this game, because otherwise it's going to drag you down, because all it takes is like 2 or 3 days of not going to the gym, and your guy's going to spend like weeks trying to recover. It's
like real life.
It really is. It really is. But I played it on PC for the review, and when I reviewed it, I said that, and I didn't know at the time that it was actually coming to iOS, but my comment was, because, you know, I played Game Dev Story first on iOS, and I really dug it on iOS, but I was like, I feel like this game would work better on mobile. Lo and behold, 3 days later, they announced the iOS version, and I was like, okay, you know, I was comped the PC version for review, and then I went, okay, you know what? I will buy this on mobile, because I felt, you know, I even put it in my own fucking review that this game is fun, but I feel like it would be even better on mobile, and I 100% right. It is the perfect kind of, because just kind of the monotonous action of it, if you sit there at a PC for a long time, you're going to just kind of zone out, just zone out and lose your mind, because it will just kind of slowly suck away your will to live. But it's still really fun. It's fun.
That's great.
It's just like, but if you're playing it on mobile, on iOS, or I think it's available on Android, It's one of those where you can kind of play it in short bursts. You don't have to sit there and play it for a long extended period of time. And I feel like that's the perfect way to consume this game, because it's not... You can sit there and play it in a big long play session, sure, if you want to. But most likely, if you're playing it on mobile, you're not going to have time to deal with the monotonous of it. You're just going to get to the point where you're going to be like, okay, all right, this session's done. Move on to, you know, something else, or, you know, check my Facebook status, or I'm done taking a poop, you know, well, whatever happens, and you're just going to move on. And so in that respect, I feel like it's the perfect game for mobile. It's awesome. And it's actually cheaper on mobile too, by the way. It is $4.99 on iOS. It is, I think, $15 on... No, I'm sorry. It's $9.99.
It's $9.99.
Yeah, it's $9.99 on Steam right now. But great game. It's awesome. It's so much fun. And there's a lot of fun twists to the story that take these fun permutations on these action flicks and fighting movies from a long time. And by the way, Ross, to specifically address your comment about Fight Club, yes, you are introduced to a guy by the name of Tyler D. And you can say, I want to prove myself. And all of a sudden, he just starts bringing in random guys to try to fuck you up. And you end up just fighting out in the back of the parking lot out back behind a bar. Just shit. But no, it's just a great time. It's so much fun. I give it very high recommendations. But that said, I feel like you're going to be able to, one, enjoy it more. And it's gonna be something that, yes, it'll be drug out a little bit more. But I think ultimately you're going to have a better experience if you're playing it on mobile. But, you know, it is available on PC as well if you, you know, wanted to jump down that road. But I just feel like the best experience would be on mobile.
Yeah, I when I got this in my inbox, I saw boxing and micromanagement. I was like, this is for Blake. He will love this.
And what's funny is I knew nothing about this game until I saw the description of it. I was like, where the fuck do I sign up? Please.
And the funny thing is that they had decided that they weren't releasing the game until Twitch beat it. To the day that Twitch beat it, they released it. It took a week.
Did it really? It
took a week. Wow. And they said, so Twitch made some bad decisions and we ended up in prison.
Yep, sounds about right.
Oh dear.
Oh, it's a blast though. I want other people to try it. It's really fun. Did any of you guys play Game Dev Story?
Yep.
I own it. Never played it.
Okay. All right. Well, if you did like kind of like the Game Dev Story type approach, I think you'd really like it. And the humor is really good.
I don't know if my camera's gonna, but it is sitting right there.
Did you buy it?
Not yet.
Buy it. You know you want to. Do it.
The worst part is, like, I'll buy a game on Steam for $10. This is $5.
$4.99.
$4.99.
Fuck that. I could get a game for $1.
I have to put in my fucking password as opposed to my...
Chris, it's half of the price of the Steam game, and it's the same goddamn game. Whatever. And it actually plays better on iOS.
It doesn't matter. I'm putting in my goddamn password right now.
How many characters is your fucking password, man?
It's a lot.
Mine's like 17, 18 characters.
What the fuck?
Yeah. I mean, it's gotta be secure.
I'm pretty sure you could do 6, and if you mix characters and numbers in there, you're golden.
No, because that's easy for a machine to hack. You want it hard for a machine to hack, but easy for a human to remember, so you write a sentence.
Yeah, like donkey throw punch.
Like I'm a really lonely person who's...
I mean, my passwords are all like donkey throw punch.
I have never once thought about writing a sentence.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's a sentence you can remember, you can type it out really quick, as opposed to like a whole bunch of random characters, but like 8, like, because that could be easily brute forced. You just do like a sentence.
The one that got me was I had one of my coworkers, he was like, I was like, yeah, sorry, the system says you need to reset your password. And he goes, oh, okay. I was like, what would you like it to be? And he goes, fuck passwords. I was like, seriously? He goes, yeah, my password. I want it to be fuck passwords. I was like, okay. Put it through the analysis. It was like, yep, got the highest tier of AES security rating. Congratulations.
Yeah. And there
that's
you go.
Because of all the characters.
Punch
you
got bust.
You bought it?
Fucking punch bust. It's not even going to show up. It doesn't matter.
But, no, it actually showed up. It showed up. Chris, I want to know what you think of it. I think it's really rad.
Well, I've watched like 3 streams of it, so...
Oh, okay. My description didn't sell it to you. All right. Fuck you, man.
I was getting a drink while you were talking about it, so.
Exactly. I see how it is. I see how it is. All right, so who's steering the ship? Where are we moving next?
Let's go to Ross.
Ross?
Hey, that's me. I've been playing Assassin's Creed, but I talked about that on the Game of the Year podcast.
Yeah, you did.
So I don't really want to talk about Assassin's Creed anymore.
Okay, so what else have you been playing?
I want to talk about League of Legends because there's a new season. It's got dynamic here. It's really cool. But you guys don't want to listen to me talk.
It's fine.
You guys don't really want to listen to me talk about...
I'd rather listen you talk about that than...
I'll talk about this one time in the middle of winter when me and Chris and Blake went off to the middle of nowhere in GFP, and we played pinball together.
Fuck yeah!
And Chris
broke
so many pinball tables. It was ridiculous.
Seriously, Chris, I'm pretty sure the only way Chris could have broken more tables is if he had a fucking hammer in his back pocket. I mean, seriously.
We broke so many pinball tables.
And we played some, like, light gun games.
Yeah, that was fun.
That cost
a ton.
More than the app that Chris just bought.
Yeah, absolutely.
Blake spent so much money for us to beat House of the Dead.
Goddamn right, and it was worth it.
We drank a lot.
Fucking worth it.
And then we went to like the pinball center place, and I remember setting a high score. How many high scores did you guys set?
Fucking hate.
Really?
Ross set a really high score on a table that was already fucked.
I set it on that table, and then you two both broke it separately.
Broken already.
You both broke it separately.
I was on a high score run when the fucking ball got gobbled up by the goddamn winged monkeys. That's an actual thing.
This shit is being bad at the game.
It was a Wizard of Oz table, and the fucking monkeys ate my balls.
Like old pinball tables suck, but modern pinball tables are
so
super
good.
Cool.
So good. You know what? Okay, I will say this. So
this makes me so happy that they actually admitted that they enjoyed pinball.
No,
does make me just
so
giddy.
I sent this to you, Blake. During Awesome Games Done Quick, had pinball games done quick.
They did. Yep.
And it was done by Pinball
easy.
Joe.
You just don't hit the little flippers and it's over.
I actually spent almost as much time watching pinball games done quick as I did AGDQ. And AGDQ was done... It was... a 24-hour stream for 7 days, and then I went back and watched the VODs of Pinball Joe's streams because they had the Wizard of Oz table that
this makes me
fucking
so happy.
Douchebag fucking here happy. Fucking just rocked, which was awesome because Pinball Addict here couldn't beat Ross.
Up by the winged monkeys.
We kept playing versus in like. I just like was too tired to like continue playing. Like, I'm so done with pinball. You lost so many games in a row. I'm not having fun anymore. This is so boring. Win so we can go home.
The most fun part for me was that I looked out and the people that were running the pinball arcade area would look at Blake like, dude, you need to chill the fuck out. Because Blake would get pissed off at Ross. Because Ross would kick Blake's ass every fucking time. He kicked your ass 6 ways from Sunway.
It was like an order of magnitude. Every time you messed up and you were just like
no,
you're like walking over like that. There's like the arcade one. You just like smacked and broke and shattered. Crashed into windows.
It was 6 times that Blake was like, "No, I'm done. After this, I'm done." And then Ross would hit the start button, and Blake was like, "Okay, one more time. And after this, I'm done." One more time, and I'm good.
And Blake is just like, no, we're going to play till I win. six or seven times later, eventually.
And then I will say,
I see how it is.
Going your score out, wasn't any better, but mine was way worse.
I can say this, going out with that, Blake
that means
and
that you
Ross.
You got fucking lucky. See.
I got tired of
winning.
Going out with you two really? To play arcade games, like when we did the Pac-Man, the Turtles. Even though Blake dropped a ton of money on Turtles and
the Pac-Man battle table. That was rad too. That was really fun.
Oh, it was like that was such a good night. And then 3 days later, one of the guys from the four-wheeling club that I'm part of, he had made a comment about going to the Grimes place. And I was like, I was just there. It was so much fun.
Yeah. And here's the funny thing. So I've been going down to play pinball down at Up Down for like 3 years now, something like that. So pretty much since I think it opened like 3 years ago, like right around when it opened. And so we moved out here. We've been here a year and a half. No? Yeah, a year and a half. Anyway, it turns out that there's an actual pinball arcade, like it's a dedicated pinball arcade in Grimes, less than 10 minutes from my house. I had no fucking idea, and it's been going for 5 years. Like nobody thought to tell me.
And it's way better than Uptown. They Uptown serves alcohol, which is better, but the experience at the other places.
Yeah.
And just to describe it, they've got a whole wall. Yeah, they've got a whole wall. They've got probably 10 or 15 tables on the one wall, which is just like the normal area. It's like the open for the peasants. And then and then there's the velvet rope section that has all of the new fancy schmancy tables and the virtual pinball tables. And like you got your AC/DC, you've got Star Trek, you've got whatever the fuck that like haunted house shit.
Yeah, the haunted house one wasn't good.
That needed work.
The Star Trek one was my jam.
And then Wizard of Oz
was like
the Wizard of Oz was pretty fucking badass. Actually, I was pleasantly surprised. Yeah. I honestly like because the people who made that Wizard of Oz table, that's their first ever pinball table they've ever produced.
By the way, I went and looked. So,
Jersey Jack pinball. Yeah.
The worst part was that I had so much fun during this little experience and
so happy. You actually enjoyed
pinball. It was a very good time. I had a really good Saturday just like roaming around playing Pac-Man with you two and then playing Turtles and then watching Ross beat House of the Dead 2 for us.
Didn't we beat Battletoads?
We did not play Battletoads at all. You said, "Hey, let's go play Battletoads." And we looked at you and laughed.
There was the other one.
And then we played Ninja Turtles.
Turtles, okay. Turtles. Yeah.
I watched someone play Battletoads blindfolded.
Yeah, I did too.
It was probably a better monster.
It was AGDQ.
Yeah. Okay. It's definitely the best way to experience the game, though.
Anyway, after we got done with that Saturday of our pinball arcading game with Blake, I actually went and looked up some of these table prices.
Oh my God.
The Wizard of Oz table that you guys so loved.
And by the way, that was the deluxe version of that table.
Yeah, the deluxe version was just, it was $10,500.
Yeah.
For that table that you guys kept having to bump to get the fucking ball that was stuck.
Goddamn winged monkeys! How many times do I have to say this? Fuck the monkeys!
But Ross had never had any problems.
I never had any problems. It's weird. Huh?
I really enjoyed the Star Trek table. That was like $7,500.
The cheapest of those was the AC/DC.
Like it had haptic feedback. Like it shook when it, like you
like
hit
when
it.
The ship was taking off all of a sudden.
And by the way, it wasn't AC/DC. It was Kiss.
Yeah.
Sorry. Well, there is an AC/DC actually too.
Big difference.
Yeah, you like
actually there is
a ball up Gene Simmons' mouth.
Yep, right
and the best part, the best part was, is that there was a House of the Dead table or a House of the Dead arcade game.
Yep.
That we spent, I don't what was it, $10.50 just to beat that fucking game.
At least $10 in it.
And then we could play it for free.
Yeah.
At this place, I was just like, it was so bad.
Damn it! Yeah.
I broke the Super Mario Brothers 3 game.
You touched. Seriously, Chris?
Yeah,
I broke the Super Mario pinball table.
Yeah.
What else
monster.
Did I did I bring the Terminator table? No, I didn't bring. I think I brought the Transformers table.
I brought the Wizard of Oz table once too. Not as bad as Blake.
Well,
broke
no, not as bad as Blake. I did break the Wizard of Oz table.
Like it went through like an existential crisis.
It couldn't find its balls. It literally.
It's like, where are my balls? I can't find them.
It's like, yeah.
Exactly, I broke so much shit.
And Chris, he then went and broke the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles table. Or no, that table was just shit to begin with. It was always broken. That's a terrible fucking table.
Yeah. Nothing so if you're going to play pinball with God Chris, just don't. Because apparently I jump balls up where they don't belong. And
story of your life.
Yeah, Chris puts balls where they don't belong.
Yeah, I put balls where they don't belong.
So that was a good Christmas gift.
That was a good we had a really good time. And in fact, the best part was that when
his wife paid us or
to hang out with me. Yeah, exactly.
And the best part was that she was like, this is going to be 3 hours, and it was, what, eight, 9 hours?
Like 8 or 9 hours later, It's like she thought that we were going to be back by supper. Nope, we
went
back.
And got some Chinese pizza.
Yep. Oh, that Chinese pizza was so good.
That's true. Pizza with the crab rangoons. It's fucking awesome.
The crab rangoon pizza was so fucking
good. Oh, my God, it's to die for. Dear Lord, it was so good.
Anyway.
Seriously, I want some crab rangoon pizza now. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thanks.
You're welcome. So good.
Right. Let's end this. So, Carrie, what has been your addiction of the month?
I've already talked about it.
Oh, well, okay.
Yeah.
It's your turn.
Tower of Monsters.
Yeah. Chris, what's your addiction?
So this is something that I just saw on Twitch the other day from an Elite Dangerous player. He was playing Evercron Legacy. It's on
That's
Steam.
That's not a word.
Evocron Legacy.
Evercron.
Did you kiss your mother with that mouth?
Do you know how many words in games are not really words?
So...
Metal Gear Solid Revengeance.
Ross, this is something that you'll want to pay attention to. So, it's... I mean, you take Elite Dangerous, right? Like, you have all these star systems that you can go around and fly to and mine and trade and pirate. And now you have planetary landings thanks to Elite Dangerous Horizons. Well, apparently, Evercron has been a thing for a while. They had Evercron Mercenary, and now they just released Evercron Legacy. And it is Elite Dangerous to, like, the next level. And the best part is Evercron Legacy is coded by one person. Legacy was then modeled by two extra people. So it's like a three-man team making a space sim. Yes, your system is, I don't know, 25 to maybe 50 star systems. So you don't get the 400 billion star systems that Elite Dangerous has. But
who has time for that anyway?
Yeah. Evercron Legacy allows you to not only do everything that you can do in Elite Dangerous, but you can also build your own star bases. You can build your own planetary bases. They had already built in the whole planetary landings, so you didn't have to wait for Horizons to come out. And they have... The guy that coded it actually coded things as small as your inertia. So when you're flying along and you're in space and you stop, you know, your acceleration, you just drift.
Yeah.
So you actually have to have your dampening systems on. So that way you can either turn them on. So that way your drift is counteracted by boosters so you don't drift as far, or you can turn it off and just drift until you decide to stop drifting. Whereas in
like the new Fast and Furious movie,
whereas
Tokyo Drift,
just never stop drifting. But in, like, Elite Dangerous, that whole inertia system is just not really there. It's like you kind of drift a little bit, but...
The ship's computer takes care of it for you.
Yeah, well,
up.
You can turn that off. And this is, like, you just... And it,
nice.
It comes into play a lot when you're doing, like, space station docking, if you're dogfighting. you really won't.
Does it have like any sort of story? Or is it just more like
it's
a base
luckily, it's luckily dangerous. It's here's your ship. And unlikely dangerous where you have to buy your ships. This one you just buy parts and then make your ship however you want. So you can have a totally unique ship. The other thing that I very much enjoyed about this is that it's IP based. So if you're going to do multiplayer, it's all based off of server. So you can actually just connect with friends and just play with friends, or connect to a public server and then play that way. Or you can play single player and just be like, fuck it, and do whatever you want to do. And your ship kind of carries over based off of, you know, however your progress has been, regardless of if you're playing multiplayer or single player. But what I really liked is that, you know, if you're going to play multiplayer, you can create your own server, invite your friends, say, here's my IP, and then you just play with friends as opposed to playing with a bunch of random people.
Ribble raffle.
The other aspect of it is that it's highly mod friendly. And I've already started modding my own Evacron. So, like, I have my own nebulas, and now they have asteroids in, and they're getting to planets. So, you know, it's so mod-friendly that all you do is basically create an environment folder and then just drop the mods into the environment. And it just continuously makes the game better looking, because it's, like I said, it was made by basically three people. One guy doing all the coding, who was handling all the small stuff, and then two modelers.
It looks like kind of like No Man's Sky, actually.
Yeah, except for it's not procedurally generated, so it's not like, right, it's here's like planet A and here's planet B. We just slapped a different coat of paint on it. It's much smaller. It's a much smaller set of star systems, and yet, while you would think that it's a smaller star system, that it would be so much easier to get between all the little nodes, Like, I watched a guy run out of fuel drifting into a space station and was hoping that his shields were enough that he could bounce off the walls and hit the docking point and then had to self-destruct just a couple pixels away because he had no fuel left.
Oh, that sucks.
Someone grab a rope and throw him. Yeah.
give him a life raft. Just pull him in.
I mean, the game is still extremely punishing as far as, you know, you really need to plan all that stuff out. And it's so, all the little minute details are so perfectly programmed that it looks like it's a game from like 2008, 2005. The graphical detail is really bad, but the modding community is already there, and they're already starting to up, you know, what you see in space and what your HUD looks like, what the space stations look like. It is ridiculous, and it took me, I don't know, I watched this guy play for about an hour, and I was like, okay, so it's, I think, $22, $23 on Steam now. And I was like, okay, so I bought it, and then I started playing. I was like, this is what Elite Dangerous needed to be. Because it's everything. It's, you see a planet, you just fly to it. You didn't have to buy it. You just fly to the planet, you do your planetary ascent, you go in there, and then if you have the material, you just start building a base on the planet. Hell, if you want to build a base outside that planet, just build it. If you have the materials for it, just go ahead and build it. The mining
is much
better.
You're probably still not building beds, are you?
Fuck no! Those bitches still have the fucking forestry to build their own goddamn beds. Unlike Blake, who has built his settlement, I am all like, no. Fuck you all. Well, you're not really talking to
me. Mine's pretty much like... It's awesome. What?
Oh. You told.
Just watch the video later.
Yeah, just watch the video later. It's great.
Okay.
Yeah, just so sue me.
No. It's just like what happened 3 seconds ago.
Your audio was very delayed. So like you're like.
And cut out.
I like Ross. So, Ross.
Like a really poorly dubbed Japanimation.
Yeah. I have this directly connected into my router. I'm sorry if it's way off. I'm really sorry.
Well, you probably should have gotten up to go to the bathroom.
Sweetie, we're not blaming you. We're just laughing at you.
Yeah. We know it's not your fault, but it's still funny. So
we know it's not your fault, but we're laughing at you.
You're
like
just
it
special.
God damn it. Before this gets any worse.
Fucking A.
Ross,
we can't have nice things.
Ross, I think you would actually like Evercron Legacy.
I probably would.
But you'll never play it because you're too busy. Now it's too busy. League of Legends Wolf. Season 5, so.
Yep. I think is it Season 6 or Season
5? No, Season 5.
It's Season
Jesus
5.
Jesus Christ.
There's been so many.
I actually have to have my ear to the esports community now.
And the best part, and the best part is that now the Challenger Series is 2 days, no, it's 4 days, in front of the actual LCS.
Okay.
Now that they've started it, so.
You know what this means, Ross? This means Carrie's gonna actually have a reason to talk to you now.
I'm not handling the MOBA area. I'm trying to get permission to bring on somebody to do the MOBA area. But
is that Ross?
No.
Probably for the best.
Ross didn't have time.
No, he's too busy. He's too busy actually playing the game.
They actually just finished. They just did their EU Challenger Series today. So tomorrow starts the EU. The worst part about this. Tomorrow starts the American Challenger Series, round 2, and then starts the EU LCS week 2.
Well, no.
EU is right.
LCS started today.
No.
It goes Thursday, Friday, and NA goes Saturday.
Chewie, get me out of here.
I know. I have an LCS fantasy team. I was watching my scores.
All right.
Wait, what?
Yes, of course I drafted all my players.
Sorry.
Got my top, mid, ADC, support, jungler, my flex, and my team.
Yeah.
Along with three bench players. You drafted all three from
the
among the...
The League of Legends fantasy series is like a big ordeal. In fact, the commentators...
Please tell me they have DraftKings. They have DraftKings for that.
Yes. Actually, they do have DraftKings for LCS.
Okay, you know what? I think fantasy football is stupid to begin with, but this just takes the cake. This is awful.
This is really fucking
stupid.
Today, Hjarnan did really good for me.
Why did you take over my screen with this shit?
We'll see how Aphromoo, Rush, and Impact do.
Everybody's
on Dick Picks.
Just so we're all aware.
John's Fallon.
What the fuck is the matter with these people?
They're all Canadian.
Hold on. Down there, it was King Fucking Potato.
Just so we're all clear, what Ross...
fucking Dick Picks.
No. What Ross just shared didn't really show up because it showed up behind all the video, all the webcams. So.
I saw it loud and clear. How exciting for me.
I know.
But I'm the one recording, so it doesn't show up on top. So
it's okay.
For the listeners who have no idea what we're going, we don't want to see that. Ross just shared with us his fantasy league team, which... Yeah. You know, seriously, I think fantasy football is sad enough. I can't believe that.
Carrie, you know what it is, just so you realize.
For jocks.
Carrie,
it's sad.
Yeah.
No, it's amazing. It's awesome. It's the one D&D that I'll actually engage in.
Okay. Just so, Carrie, you realize that in like the next 2 years, we'll probably have fantasy fighting game leagues, right?
That doesn't even make sense.
It doesn't make
fantasy
sense.
Fantasy what?
It's not a team-based sport.
Fighting game leagues?
Like League of Legends
No.
is.
No.
Oh, yeah, you will. No. Because I want to see fucking Sonic Fox just win it all in Mortal Kombat.
Well, that's not a fantasy team.
It's still a fantasy league.
Chris, have you ever done fantasy sports before?
Yes, I did fantasy hockey once. And then I was like, this is so dumb, I am out.
Okay, all right. It's hard when they play more than once a week.
See, I can't even call fantasy football D&D for jocks because you're still not doing it.
Yeah. You're not like, do so much as roll a dice. It's just not... It's more like
I'm number one in the draft list. Woo!
It's more like it is spreadsheet maneuvering. It's Excel Masters, what it is.
So it's like a hybrid between D&D and
no, World it's Warcraft. Not D&D.
It's more like
it is Excel Masters.
I got this from Pat. Then it's perfect.
That explains why Blake likes it so much.
Yeah, it's amazing. Hey, don't judge me.
That was really
just
funny.
Saying you like micromanagement.
Did we ever talk about
this? I mean, look at your settlement in Fallout 4.
Ended number one and lost to me in the playoffs.
Okay, so we are train spiraling the fuck out.
To the playoffs. I just sort of showed up.
Get us the fuck out of here.
Gary.
I'm not closing it out.
I don't want to talk
about this. You're not closing up? All right, fine. Fuck it. I'll do it. So, you can follow us all on Twitter. I'm at Starvin. Carrie here is at Crunchy Chocobo. Blake here is at Grundy the Man.
Yo.
This is at Trollmaster. I mean,
Ross
Greedy
just
Raven.
Tried to give his cat beer. Just saying.
He's petting
his... cat likes beer.
Oh, whatever. The site is at Sherry Reviews.
And she's just so, off in my arms, just like,
I would go ahead and say,
you've had too much kitty.
Like and follow us here. Let me just bring this giant window up right in your recording session.
Because
I don't
now?
Care. You can't see it. Doesn't matter.
Doesn't really matter. Cool. Just
so, Carrie's had enough wine. I've had enough rum and coke. Blake has had two sips of beer, and Ross has had a sniff of beer.
Beer number four. Come on, man. Give me a break.
Congrats. So we're all drunk. It was that.
And Ross is too busy fondling a pussy right now.
Yep, exactly. He's doing feeling it up something fierce.
But hey, Ross is
somebody
wearing...
Somebody on the show has to.
Ross is wearing a very kick-ass shirt with a callback to the last
so
book
so many things to say, but I'm
Don't! This is a dark stage of my life, and I don't want to discuss it ever again. We will never speak of it again.
So, on that note, because Blake can't read a fucking... How you're gonna level your? Yeah. I'm number two. Really? I'm number two. With that, remember, don't be a dick on the internet like this dude right here. Just don't be a dick like Blake Grundman.
I'm the nicest guy don't be out here. I'm the nicest guy on.
Whatever.
Here.
So we're all gonna tell you who not to be a. Remember, Ross was petting a cat. Carrie is awesome. Blake is a dick. And with that, we're out. Peace.